collection box is in the front of the church, and you can put your envelope in there if you have one on the way out. Once again, we will have ushers directing us to communion, so just wait in your pews. If you haven't been here before, the ushers will tell you when to come up, show you kind of, we had to reconfigure the approaches a little bit, so we'll be doing that. And then after Mass, we would ask people to stay into your pews, and we will, the ushers will dismiss people one section at a time, once again, to keep us socially distanced from each other and safe so that we can worship and thank God for all the good things in our lives. So thank you very much, and we'll get started with Mass in just a minute.
Welcome to St. Julie Billier. Let us pray for the special intentions that are recorded in our Book of Intercessions and for the sick among us. Nancy Bruno, Rosemary Barkus, Rita Casso, Gabby Palma, Norbert Sisla, Jim Nevin, Kevin Dexter, and Anthony Brock. We also remember those who have died, Joseph Horsius. And at this Mass, we also remember Bernadette Christ, Jack Norris, Vito Ventrella, Sandri Wierzbinski, Edward Day Sr., Bonnie Deenan, Winnie Durkin, and Mary Jane Warren. We ask that you now silence all cell phones and other electronic devices. Let's take a moment to remember that we are in God's presence.
Come all you people, come and praise your Maker. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. We come once again today as God's people, recognizing that we are asked to give to God what belongs to Him. And so for the times that we have failed in that responsibility, let us turn to God once again for mercy and forgiveness. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever-Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed Cyrus, whose right hand I grasp, subduing nations before him and making kings run in his service. opening doors before him and leaving the gates unbarred. For the sake of Jacob, my servant of Israel, my chosen one, I have called you by your name, giving you a title, though you knew me not. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. It is I who arm you, though you do not know me, so that toward the rising and the setting of the sun, people may know that there is none beside me. I am the Lord. There is no other. The word of the Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy to the Church of the Thessalonians. In God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, remembering you in our prayers, unceasingly calling to mind your work of faith and labor of love and endurance in the hope of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before our God and Father, knowing, brothers and sisters, loved by God, how you were chosen. For our gospel did not come to you in word alone, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with much conviction. The word of the Lord.
brought to us through God's Son, Jesus Christ. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. The Pharisees went off and plotted how they might entrap Jesus in speech. They sent their disciples to him with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are a truthful man and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. And you are not concerned with anyone's opinion, for you do not regard a person's status. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it lawful to pay the census tax to Caesar or not?" Knowing their malice, Jesus said, "Why are you testing me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin that pays the census tax." Then they handed him the Roman coin. He said to them, "Whose image is this, and whose inscription?" They replied, "Caesar's." At that he said to them, "Then repay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Repay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God. Those were the words in our gospel today. They are words that we have heard very often before. They are words that we may have even used at one time or another. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. We have understood that to mean what belongs to the government, give to the government. What belongs to a secular organization, give it back to them. And of course, what belongs to the secular world belongs in the secular world. What belongs to God is to be given back to God. Now, in many instances, we have understood this phrase to refer to material things, what our donations must be, or whatever, and things of that nature. But what if it means something a lot deeper than that? To understand, let's take a look at the coin that is mentioned in the gospel. So the coin in the gospel, on one side, bore the image of Caesar Augustus, because he was the emperor at that time. On the other side of the coin was imprinted words that simply proclaimed and declared that Caesar Augustus was not only the emperor, but that he himself was also a god. And so the imprint on both sides indicated that the emperor was not just a earthly ruler, but he was also worshipped as being a god. And so the image of the believed to be divine emperor was prominent in the currency of the time. And so to this Jesus declares, if it's Caesar's image on the coin, then it belongs to him, so give it back to him. But again, in further response, we hear Jesus say those words that we ought to give to God what belongs to God. And so whatever bears the image of God belongs to him. Whatever bears the image of God is what needs to be given back to God. Now, of course, we need to understand this not in the sense of any earthly currency, even those that may have phrases like "in God we trust," because again, there is something deeper that we need to be aware of. And we need to ask ourselves, what bears the image of God? If we think back to creation, if we think back to the story of creation in Genesis, and we know that in creating us, God created us in his image and likeness. And so the imago Dei, the image of God, has been imprinted on every human soul because God is the creator of all human life. But furthermore, for us who are disciples, for us who were baptized into the faith, that image and likeness goes even further and goes even deeper. Because at baptism, the forehead of the one baptized is marked with the sign of the cross, literally and symbolically writing the name of Jesus onto the forehead to remind the person and remind everyone that the image and likeness of God has already been written on that person, and that he or she were created in God's image and likeness, and that image and likeness has been restored by God himself in Jesus. And so if we follow that logic, what bears the image of God is nothing else but our very soul. And so if that is the case, that is what we give back to God, is our very selves. However, the next thing we need to reflect on is, what are we giving back? If we were created in the image of God, does God's image in us shine loud and clear? Or is God's image in us distorted? If we were created in the likeness of God, how much like God are we? Again, if we were created in the image and likeness of God, is the image of God in us obscured? Is it tainted? Is it a case that we are giving back to God something that has become less than what we need to give him? Because if we believe that God is the best and he deserves only the best, then what are we giving him in our lives? And these are the very questions that we must come before God with, because these are the questions that come with that command to give back to God what belongs to God. To be clear, the image of God does not have anything to do with physical traits, but the image of God that has been imprinted onto our very souls is the share that we have in God's perfection. It is our call to be constantly holy as God is holy, to be perfect as God is perfect. Now, obviously, we are not yet at that same level of perfection and holiness as God himself, and perhaps we never will be in this lifetime. But the question still remains, are we striving each day to match that perfection and holiness that we see in God himself? Because that, again, is what we need to offer back to God. Furthermore, the likeness of God has also been imprinted on us, declaring that not only do we belong to God, but we are also like God. The likeness of God in which we have been created is simply our share in the life of God and in our share in the power of God, our share to be like God in the world, the power to love, the power to bring life, the power to heal, the power to sanctify, and the power to save. Are our lives then about those very same things? To love as God loves, to bring life as God brings life, to heal as God heals, to make holy as God makes holy, and to save souls rather than to condemn them. The way we live out our discipleship, aware of the image and likeness of God in each and every one of us, that again becomes what we give back to God. And so the question is, what are we giving him? The goal of every human life is to become an instrument of God, whether one knows it or not. And that is what we learn in the first reading. Because King Cyrus was actually a pagan ruler, but yet God still used him for his purposes. And so if King Cyrus, who was not even a disciple of God, was able to be an instrument in God's hands, how much more ought we to allow our own lives to be used by God as his instruments in the world? We who acknowledge that the image and likeness of God have been imprinted on us must all the more be intentional about what we give to God, making sure that what we are giving him truly is the very best. Paul, furthermore, in the second reading, tells the Thessalonians that he gave thanks to God always for them. Why? For the simple reason that the Thessalonians, despite all of their limitations, still strove to be the best version of themselves. In this, they were allowing the image and likeness of God in which they have been created to shine through them, and they became instruments of God. And so again, the goal must be the same for us. The more we are aware of the image and likeness of God in which we have been created and restored in Jesus, the more we will allow that image and likeness to reflect themselves through us and in us. And we do so in order to become God's instruments in the world. But again, we need to ask ourselves, what are we giving? Are we giving back to God the image of him that was imprinted onto our souls? Or are we giving back to God something less than what God deserves? And so in this Eucharist, we again come together at this altar to commit ourselves once again to giving to God only what belongs to him, the very best version of who each of us are called to be. Together we profess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And let us approach the living God, willing to let go of our own needs, so that we may place before God the needs of others.
For the church, to live always as God's people, recognizing the Holy Spirit who dwells in each one of us, we pray to the Lord. For those who lead our country, may they respond to the cries of the poor and the oppressed, even in the midst of other trying issues. We pray to the Lord. For our parish community, as we continue to live our faith by our hospitality to those on the margins of society, as Jesus did in his ministry, we pray to the Lord. For the work of missionaries, may they be strengthened in body and spirit as they bring Christ's message of mercy to the ends of the earth. We pray to the Lord. For those suffering illness, to be healed and renewed by the Spirit of God, we pray to the Lord. For our faithful departed, to be joyful forever in God's presence, we pray to the Lord.
Generous God, you have blessed us with life and love, with mercy and goodness. Help us to share that mercy and goodness with the least of our sisters and brothers, and to be instruments of your grace to the ends of all the earth. Hear this and all our prayers through Christ our Lord. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
The Lord accepts sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right, and it is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy, for you are the one God, living and true, existing before all ages and abiding for all eternity, dwelling in unapproachable light. Yet you, who alone are good, the source of life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so, in your presence are countless hosts of angels who serve you day and night, and gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. With them we too confess your name in exaltation, giving voice to every creature under heaven as we acclaim.
Comes in the name of the Lord.
We give you praise, Father most holy, for you are great, and you have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when, through disobedience, he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death, for you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offered them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior, made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, and to the sorrowful of heart joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may this same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. For the celebration of this great mystery, which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, and he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit. They may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis our Pope, Blaise our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who partake in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your blessed and with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation freed from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy
kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And your
spirit. Let us offer one another a socially distant sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall.
As you come forth for Holy Communion, please do so at the instruction of the greeter assigned to your section. The communion ministers will distribute to sections 2 and 4 and 5 first, and then section 1 and 3. As you exit your pew, please exit to your right and return on your left. We ask that you maintain the 6-foot safety distance and sanitize your hands before receiving the body of Christ. Those receiving low-gluten hosts should exit their pew with their section, and instead of going to the minister, walk to the side of the altar and wait for a minister to return. We appreciate your help in providing a safe worship space for all.
an act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal through Christ our Lord. So who has a wedding anniversary in October? How many years? 20 years? 11? 17? 37? Okay. Anyone over 50? 56 years. That's a good testament. So again, if you are anywhere near those who raised their hands, please direct your prayer of blessing over them. I myself am going to direct it towards the west because in Denver, Colorado, my brother and my sister-in-law live out there and they're celebrating their 15th anniversary this month as well, so mine is going out that way. But together, let us ask God's blessing. O God, creator of all things, who in the beginning made man and woman that they might form the marriage bond, bless and strengthen the union of your servants, that they may show forth an ever more perfect image of the union of Christ with his church, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
And again, let us congratulate them. So just a couple of announcements. We are selling our Bonanza raffle tickets. We've sold about 100 tickets already. We need to sell about 400 more. I know it's a tough time. I know people are hurting in many different ways. But remember that the parish community is also has also suffered and has been impacted by our new reality. So if you are able, please support that. Karen, I believe, is towards the narthex, selling Bonanza raffle tickets. And so again, you can get them through her or through the office or by mail. There was one other thing that I was supposed to mention. Now I can't remember it. Men's group is this week, but there was something else other than that. Okay, senior moment. if it comes to me, well, you'll find out somehow. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
My soul cries out with a joyful